All right, so like Ed told you, my name's Alfred. I work at the local Batteries Plus Bulb store. I'm actually the commercial sales rep for Batteries Plus Bulbs. So doing things like this is something that I often do. I've spoke with UVA a couple times about certain battery types for UPS units. But this is a little bit different. I've never really spoken to this particular application of ham radio. So this is exciting for me because, you know, I had to do a little bit of research to kind of try to find out what the more common batteries were for the bigger ham radio units. So that's kind of where I'm putting most of my focus today, is on the big batteries, not so much the smaller batteries that go into the handheld radios. I can always be reached at the store if anybody has any questions about those batteries specifically, even for their unit. They have any type of question, feel free. I have my card up here. Any follow-up questions, anything like that, feel free to reach out to me directly, either by email or calling me on the phone. And any day of the week, I'll be happy to spend some time going over that stuff, because that's essentially my job, is just to be a facilitator of information in the battery and lighting world. So I know we're focusing on batteries today, but if any of you have any light bulb issues, come check us out too, because we got those as well. So all right, so for today, I'm going to be focusing mostly on the advantages and disadvantages of lead and lithium technologies for larger battery options. Not so much the smaller batteries, but I do touch a little bit on the lithium batteries that have been catching fire in the Samsung phones, just because I know that was something that they, you know, did request to go over just briefly. So I'll dive right into this information. I did hand out something that is on one of these slides. I'm going to go through that slide really fast, and I've experienced it myself where somebody shows me that slide, they move it away really quick, and I'm like, wait, I wanted to see more information on that slide. So I provided that for you so you can kind of look at it if you, you know, want to look at further. But I'm going to go through that one really fast. So, all right. So, okay. So basically, with lead batteries, there's four major types of lead acid batteries. There's the general purpose, deep cycle, gel, and high rate. There's a difference. Each one is specific to a certain application. I was going to focus on the one that was specific to your application, but if I do that, what ends up happening is people oftentimes will come into our store and they'll ask for a gel battery. They'll just say, hey, do you have a gel battery? And they're actually asking for one of those four types, not necessarily a gel battery. So I have to ask the right questions to get to which one they need for their application. So basically, the key thing is know your application. I think you guys know your application. So you know what type of battery demand need you need. You know, is your battery going to sit for months just charging? Or is it going to be something that you use every week? You know, things like that. It's very important to know about your application, because that does determine which type of battery you want to use for that application. So, all right, here's that chart. It's got all the different types, and you can barely read it, right? So that's another reason why I supplied you with that. And you guys can, it does say on the bottom not to distribute that information, but you guys can keep that for your own personal records and have it. I just ask that you don't put it on the internet. That's the only thing I ask. Okay. So, all right. Already talked about these, but this kind of shows you just a very basic understanding of what each application or what each battery is good for in the application. So for deep cycle cycling, gel cycling, general purpose both, high rate only backup. I'll go into depth as to why that is, and that'll actually help you further understand a little bit more about your application, and maybe if you've used a battery in the past and it didn't perform well, maybe why that happened and what you can do differently.
Could you define backup and cycling just so we're all on the
yes.
same page, please?
I actually will go a little bit deeper into what backup and cycling in an actual visual way that helped me understand it a little bit better than just throwing out a bunch of technical jargon, which I think in this crowd would probably be the better. Most of the time, if I do that, I just see eyes gloss over. But let's see. Here we go. This is the slide that I have that kind of explains that a little bit better. So if we look at the visual graphic, cycling, you're always constantly using the battery. There's never that period where it's charging. Now, with this, you can see this is backup. So always being charged with AC power, and then all of a sudden, boom, power goes out. We're using the battery for that period of time that the power goes out, power's back on, it's now backup. We're using AC power the whole time. So that's backup. So really, for backup applications, you really only want to use general purpose or high rate batteries. So that, I don't really think, comes into play for your applications. Now, I know that sometimes we only use the equipment in seem like a good alternative, but really those batteries aren't used only once, twice, maybe three times, and then they're replaced. So it's not really something that's used that often. It is usually an expensive battery too, because it's meant to be that lifesaver for when the power goes out. It's a very, you know, usually on big security systems that, like for the National Grounds Intelligence Center, you know, if their power goes out, building's on lockdown. So want to make sure they got something really good in there. All right, so that kind of goes over each one of those. So you can see, you know, they focus on gel, deep cycle, and general purpose as the ones for cycling. And honestly, I think that's really the batteries that we're going to be using in backup situations mostly. All right, so general purpose, basically it works good in both applications. And one of the things I really wanted to focus on, because it's probably one of the most misunderstood things with batteries, is depth of discharge and cycles and how that plays into cycles. So if you see right here, they like to indicate in the battery world, a lot of times they throw this out. They say you get 50 to 150 cycles at 100% discharge. Well, nobody will ever recommend for you to ever discharge a battery to 100%, because that can kill it in one full discharge. So essentially, what you want to do is only take the battery to about 50%. Now, I go over that a little bit further in some other slides, but I wanted to focus on that right off the bat, because some of the information that I'm going to be going over might be a little conflicting. So basically, with this battery, it's almost always charging, and it never really goes through cycles. And as a good rule of thumb, with any type of battery, you really only want to take it to about 50% charge.
So you're saying any type, cell phone battery, walkie-talkie battery?
No, just lead.
Oh.
We're talking lead.
Lead.
Now, I'll go over briefly, because when we start talking about lithium, that will become clear as to one of the main advantages of lithium is that you don't really have that being a problem.
You also use NiCad, but that's a lead, right?
NiCad is a little bit different, and those are primarily used mostly in the radio style batteries, and that's why I preface, because I really didn't focus on nickel cadmium, because I kind of, if I dove into nickel cadmium and nickel metal hydride, we would take this on for 2 hours.
The discharge of NiCads.
The discharge of NiCads.
Can you bring it down to 100% or never?
Well, see, with NiCads, it's strange. When you ask them how to charge it, they will tell you, basically, you don't want to create a memory. And what that is that's crystallization on the cells. And that's a result of the battery being fully discharged and recharged frequently, or not being fully discharged and being recharged. So there's the way that you can kind of clean that crystallization off is by doing the deep discharge. Because you know how they mentioned in the past the memory effect? If you don't fully discharge your battery, it's going to develop a memory. Well, that's the crystallization. To counter it, you have to deep discharge it every so often. But if you deep discharge it, it can lose a percentage of the total capacity.
If you do it too often.
If you do it too often. So they say there's a happy medium that will keep the battery going good. So that might be something that you might have noticed if you always discharge your battery and it died pretty quick on you because it was something you used frequently. Yeah. So like your cordless phone batteries for your house, oftentimes people will just throw them right back on the charger every single time. When in reality, what's meant to happen is you're supposed to take it off the charger once it's fully charged, carry it around with you till it gets low, then put it back on the charger. So it's being charged constantly all night, and then it's being deep discharged, so it's getting both. That's why they last 6-7 years, sometimes longer, and other applications, they don't last that long because they're probably sitting somewhere on a shelf always charging, never being drained down or anything. So that's nickel cadmium. Now with general purpose, we're not going to really run into general purpose that much, so I just kind of wanted to just go over some of the applications you might see it in and then just kind of go away with general purpose, because you guys really don't want to use general purpose unless you're replacing a battery in your home security system in the fire alarm panel. That's really the only place you're probably going to find a general purpose battery realistically. So high cyclic applications like golf carts, floor scrubbers, you definitely don't want to use these batteries. So like for you guys, you don't want to use them because it's got a high demand, take a big battery. All right, so it's a little bit easier way of seeing the advantages and disadvantages when it comes to using this battery as opposed to other battery types that you would want to use. So the less cycle life, the shorter shelf life, not as good for long-term or higher discharge applications, which is, I think, our application. So deep cycle, probably the battery that we're going to want to use for your application is deep cycle. It's got more active material. It's meant for cycling. It provides continuous power. So essentially, it's going to be a good battery for something that, you know, if you're not trying to just use it for backup purposes and you want to use your radio frequently, this is definitely the battery I recommend. It's going to be the most runtime, and it's meant to be drained. And once again, you never want to drain it fully. If you're draining it to the point where the battery is telling you it has nothing left to provide for your application, you're taking it down too low. And you're going to realize that determines the life of the battery right there. So if you're really using all of your battery power, what you really need to consider is take a step back and maybe say, huh, I think I need to double my battery power. So if I double my battery power, I might get 4 or 5 times the life out of it, and I'm only spending twice the money. So that's a savings right there. You're getting 4 or 5 times the life, and you're only spending twice as much. So right there, save you some money.
When you say take it down more than half, what's that voltage-wise, like 10 or?
So voltage-wise, it's about, really, you never want to take it, if you're taking your battery to about 10.5 volts, that's too low. So voltage-wise, it's about 12 volts. Your device sometimes will stop working once you take it below 12 volts. So depending upon your amp draw, the amount of current you're drawing from the battery, that number, that voltage number can sort of fluctuate based on the amp hours you have. Because if you have a large amp hour, that current draw, it could allow you to get a little bit lower because you're generating a little bit more power out of that battery.
What voltage are you starting with?
Starting with, mm-hmm. For these batteries, usually when they sit at a good healthy battery, when it's fully charged, it's about 13 volts. When they're being charged, they'll charge up and they'll be, about 14.8, and a gel is about 14.1. Now, I'll kind of highlight that in a further slide, because that's one of the things you got to be careful with if you go with a gel option, because gel is similar to deep cycle. It has its advantages, its disadvantages. One of the disadvantages is that you need a specialized charger because they can't accept a high charge rate. That'll kill the battery prematurely. So if you just go out and buy a gel battery, hook it up with your normal charger, you're going to end up with the battery problem. Might not be right away, but it's definitely not going to give you the life you need out of your battery. And you're never going to really get a good charge on it either. So deep cycle, really, I think, doing my research, I think is really the way that we want to go here. For our applications. So
you hear the term gel cell a lot.
Yes.
I don't think that is number 3 on your list here.
It's not.
Correct. Okay.
Now, gel, well, actually it is. But everybody calls AGM batteries gel cells.
Yeah.
So it's just a common thing I run into, and I think it's because of the G in the AGM. That's honestly what I think it is. They see the G and they think that that just means gel and then whatever the rest means. So it's just a common thing that we run into is everybody's like, I need a gel battery. And then we show them not a gel battery, but a different AGM or, you know, valve regulated lead acid battery. And they're like, yeah, this is exactly what I need. So gel is really only used, from what I've noticed, in certain wheelchair applications. It's really not commonly used as much as people think. It's more AGM and deep cycle and general purpose, you know, which AGM is all for. All right. Oh, actually, I didn't go over this one. Okay. So for deep cycle, you know, they go over some of your common applications. Wheelchair, electric lawnmowers, riding toys, fishing equipment, floor scrubbers, golf carts. One common thing we can see amongst all of these is it's something that's used regularly. So electric lawnmowers, because it's not using gas, and riding toys, obviously not using any gas. Fishing equipment, they focus on trolling because it's not for starting purposes. Not a good starting option.
So how does a marine battery fall in here? Is that a deep cycle battery?
Now, the fascinating thing about marine batteries is the only thing that makes a marine battery is the terminals on the top of the battery. The fact that it has an automotive post and a threaded terminal. That's actually the only thing that makes it a marine battery.
So it's still an automotive battery.
It's still an automotive battery. Now, they do make three different types of marine batteries. They make a starting battery, a deep cycle battery, and a dual purpose battery. So, and they're commonly in three different sizes because that's commonly what the battery bank in the boats are. So there is a little bit to it being more than just terminals. There's three common sizes, but essentially it's designed the same. So
I thought it was just that anything with marine on it cost 50% more.
Yeah, right. And had a low warranty and all that. Yeah, pretty much. Yeah, that's exactly what it means. So you can see I even include on this slide more cycles if not discharged below 50%. Because some people will tell you, well, 150 to 250 cycles, that doesn't sound right. I've gotten, I use my battery regularly and I've gotten about 5 to 6 years out of my battery. Well, that's because they probably have a voltage regulator on it that tells it when it gets to about halfway, and then they switch to another battery bank and charge the other one. You'll get 5 to 10 years out of a battery if you do it properly. But most times we don't charge our batteries properly, we don't maintain them properly, and sometimes we don't even get enough power, so we're using up too much of that power. So that's essentially the basics with deep cycle, and most of that information is in that handout that I gave. So once again, just going over brief advantages, disadvantages. So you get a little bit more charts, or you get a little bit more cycles than the general purpose because it's meant to be cycled. And you get a lower cost per cycle because you're paying about the same amount of money for a deep cycle that you are about a general purpose. There's really not much of a huge price difference. But you get less cycle life than gel batteries, which is really the only reason why you'd want to use a gel battery is if you had an application that you knew you'd be able to monitor how much it was being discharged from it and you wanted just a little bit longer life. There's really that, and it's a little bit safer technology to use too, which is kind of the last point in this current slide. So basically, if you're not familiar with gel, it's basically acid that is a special gel that is vacuumed into the battery. So there's no liquid electrolyte that's loose that's going to spill out of the battery, but you can still overcharge these batteries. And when you do, they're not forgiving like the other batteries where you put distilled water in them. If it discharges and the batteries vent and it vents out the hydrogen, there's no way to put that hydrogen back into the battery. So, and that's actually a reminder to me. I don't think I put my phone on silent, and my wife is notorious for calling me during these things. So I will do that. So basically, there is less corrosion in the battery. So you end up dealing with, if you keep the battery at not a full charge, you have less sulfation occurring inside that battery. So it's a little bit more forgiving if you're not charging it after use. So that's another good benefit to gel. But really, the high thermal capacity and reduced risk of thermal runaway is a good thing for this battery, because if you've ever charged a battery and it's gotten really hot and it starts to boil out the sulfation, the egg smell, the rotten egg smell, that's usually because the battery is getting too hot due to the charge rate and now it's boiling out the acid. It's a lot harder for this battery to get that far. Charger will make sure that doesn't happen. So one of the big benefits is that 300 plus cycles at 100% discharge. That's if you're draining the battery down to where your application is not working anymore. But you get more cycles if not discharged below 80%. So that's another benefit. This battery you can take, if you have a voltage monitor, you can take it down to 80%, rather than 50%, and safely take it down there without sacrificing any of that.
80% of capacity.
Yeah, 80%. So basically, you only got 20% capacity remaining in your battery. It allows you to kind of take it a little bit lower. But one of the differences between gel, deep cycle, high rate, which I'm about to get to, and general purpose, and then lithium, is the fact that with lead technology, when the battery gets that low, sometimes all the functions on our equipment stop working. It might be one function and another function's working. That is what they call voltage sag. And it happens with only lead technology, really. And it's one of the biggest flaws. And that's one of the reasons why they're pushing for lithium to hit the open market, is it can get down to 2%. And it'll still give you all your features, all your functionality and everything until it gets down to zero. Whereas there's a curve where I think it's called like this, the Peukert's curve, I believe is what it's called. And that shows you right off the bat how much power you're losing as the voltage drops. So I think I touched base on that a little bit further. But basically for gel, wheelchair, same applications as before. The difference is you're getting more charge cycles. It might cost you a little bit more on the gel. It's not like the same with deep cycle and general purpose where they cost the same. So you might be paying a little bit more, and you're gonna get that, you have to get that new charger. That's a mistake most people make. All right, so basically it also doesn't perform well below 32 degrees Fahrenheit. So if you're in cold temperatures, it's not gonna be a good option for you. It can definitely freeze a lot easier. And that's the important part, is it must be charged at 13.8 to 14.1. And they put that as a disadvantage because most chargers don't have that charge rate. All right. So high rate. High rate, not going to really touch much on. Just want you to know what it means, because when I first ran into high rate, the description of it led me to believe that it was a 10-year battery and that it would last me 10 years if I used it. Well, it's a 10-year backup battery that if you don't have any power needs within 10 years, it'll last you 10 years. But if you have a power outage, that's it. You got to replace it right after it. So very misleading in the literature, and they really, most places don't really tell you much about high rate. Pretty much high rate, we don't see it being sold much unless there's maybe like a, you know, like I was saying, backup big security systems that require these batteries in banks. But a lot of them are switching to lithium. So that's something I'll touch base on a little bit further. So best suited for float or emergency backup applications where they're always being charged, never really being used. That 10-year design life, that sounds great. Industry standard warranty on these batteries are about 3 years. And they'll always throw that caveat that if you have a power outage that and the battery gets below a certain voltage, that voids the warranty. So really, it's never really ever used. But best applications, you'll find backup for telecom systems. Like power goes out, got to keep the phone systems going. Large backup, solar power, and cable TV. So you'll see them in a lot of the phone towers, stuff like that. They'll have these batteries in them. But never use these for cyclic applications. I have run into customers that were using them for day-to-day solar applications because that's, some places advertise they're the best solar battery, and it's just not true. So that's something you want to watch out for, not get. I do not recommend high-rate batteries for your application. All right, so the downsides. Limited usable capacity. Deep cycle apps should only use 30 to 50%, so we've kind of touched base on that already. Limited cycle life. Your average cycle life, if you take it down to that depth, is about 300 cycles. You know, which realistically, if you're using it every day, that's a year. So, however, you can achieve 500 to 1,000 if you only use that 30 to 50%. And of course, that does vary based on the type of battery you selected. But for the deep cycle, that's pretty much what I focused on. Slow and inefficient charging. This is something that nobody really knows about. And I could tell you that because I run into this situation all the time. With all your lead-based batteries, the final 20% cannot be fast charged. it must be charged on a slow charger. If not, your charger, if it only has a fast setting, will say it's fully charged, and it's not. So that's something that's very important. If you ever get what they call a battery tender or a trickle charger, you don't use that for your initial charging. You use your normal charger. And then when you get to that final rate, when it's about 80%, you throw it on your trickle charger. Some trickle chargers you can buy that have both settings. That's the ones I recommend, the ones that have like a high multi-amp setting, 10, 6, 2 amps. Those are the type of chargers you want to use to charge your batteries, the big batteries. Because if you never do that, that last 20% will cause your battery to fail within a short period of time. Could be a year, could be 2 years, but definitely not going to be the industry standard of about 4 to 5 years is about what you want to get out of your deep cycle battery if you're doing it correctly. So that essentially saying failure to fully charge will age the battery. And to get a little bit more technical about that, what happens is the areas of the plates that aren't fully charged, when they're sitting there at a without the full charge, the plate will start to sulfate. And what happens is the lead dioxide will start to turn into sulfation. And the more you let it sit there, the thicker that will get, and the less likely when you go to recharge it that that will reform into the chemistry that it was prior. And if it doesn't, it'll limit how high the battery will charge. So you can notice that if you fully charge a battery, you take it off your charger, and it's only sitting at about 12.6, 12.7, that's because parts of your plates are sulfated. And the only way you could bring it back is with a specialized charger. They call it a pulse charger, and that's not a guarantee. So if you ever run into a situation like that, I'll tell you right off the bat, you can bring your batteries into us. We provide a free service where we will charge your battery, see if it'll bring it back. So that's one of the free things we do locally is we charge batteries, test them for free. So it helps you out. So just wanted to throw that out there. So one of the things with lithium technology, while I'm on this technology, is that you can fully charge it really fast to 100%. That's why they use them in cell phones and a lot of things of that nature. And that is appealing to a lot of people because when the battery gets dead, they want to use their phone right away. So in our technology, they're going to get to the point where they can fast charge the batteries. And so when your battery dies and you need to get up and running again, you can fast charge your battery instead of having to wait 10 hours for a battery to get charged up. Okay. Placement issues. I don't know if any of you have run into this. If your battery started smelling and you have it in a nice place in your house, you might wonder, is that causing any problems with the hydrogen leaking out of it? It could definitely, you might notice some metal corroding around the battery. That's something that can happen. So it's definitely something that is a problem with SLA that hopefully once lithium catches on and becomes a little bit better at a price point, will solve that problem. So I know some of you probably have added distilled water to a battery. It's never a clean situation. Always ends up being messy, especially if the acid boils out of it. So AGM and gel do not require distilled water, but like I was mentioning before, if you do overcharge it, they still can be irreversibly destroyed, and there's nothing you can do about it at that point. Okay, so now lithium iron phosphate. I don't know if that's a technology that anybody has run into recently, but this is some of the technology that's incorporated into a lot of lithium ion technology is basically what where this comes from. And right now it's arriving to the market, so it's in its early stages. You might not have run into it. I don't sell the batteries. There's some safety concerns that we'll go over, which is why a lot of places aren't selling them. You might only find them through online retailers that are willing to jump into this at an early stage. So it's definitely early stage, hasn't really fully arrived to the market. You can't go out to Costco and buy one. You can't go to Lowe's or any place like that and find them. So, and the safety concerns. Okay, one of the big advantages so
this is not the lithium batteries that we have in our cell phones right now.
It's similar. It's actually very similar. It's basically that technology blown up into a battery that could operate your ham radio, is essentially what it is. So it used to go by a different battery chemistry of lithium cobalt, and when they designed this battery chemistry, that's when they were able to shrink it into the phones, and it was safe at that point, initially, to use it for that, if they take the right safety precautions, which I'll talk about in a little bit, is why those batteries started catching on fire in Samsung phones, is because of a poor design in the battery. And I have a slide on that, so we'll touch base on that in a little bit. So with this superior usable capacity, you have 100%, 100 amp hours, you can use 85 amp hours, because they're saying lithium can use up to 85%. And with the lead technology, about 35 to 50 amp hours is all you can safely use. So extended cycle life, you're getting anywhere from 2,000 to 5,000 cycles if cared for properly, which essentially the only thing that that means is that lithium can never be taken down to zero. If it is, it can die right there. You get one use out of it and that's it, and it's done, which is a recommendation I make for your or your cell phone. If it dies, charge it. Because if you don't charge it and it sits overnight, if it's a little old, they have safety circuits in them and they will shut down. And then you won't be able to charge it and it won't do anything. So that's part of that safety circuitry, is to prevent the fires like were happening with the Samsungs. So all right, you can fast charge them to 100%. No need for the final 20% slow charge phase. They're very climate resistant. Your lead batteries, one thing I didn't touch on is with lead batteries, they like to be at room temperature. 77 degrees is about what they say is the healthy point for a battery. When you go above that or below that, it does alter the chemical reaction inside the battery. Higher, it's going to cause it to react quicker, which is actually going to raise your capacity, but by raising the capacity with the temperature, you're using it more quicker too. So like you have a 100 amp hour battery in a hotter temperature, it's probably going to raise that specific gravity a little bit, but you're going to go through that power really fast. But with lithium, you can get to negative 20 degrees and it'll provide 80% power, which if you got to negative 20 degrees Celsius, with a lithium battery, I believe, I wish I would have put that in Fahrenheit, because I know that when a lead battery gets to close to about 0 degrees Fahrenheit, which some places of the country can get that cold, it can freeze, especially if it's not fully charged. And that's why some of the cold areas of the country, like Minnesota, in the dead of the winter, you go to a sporting event, they'll have somebody jump out there actually going around in a vehicle jumping people to get them started, because pretty much everybody has battery failures. It's something that is not really thought of, but you know, cold climates can create issues for batteries. That's something that lithium is going to hopefully solve for us, and requires zero maintenance because you're not getting into the battery at all. One of the things I touched on was the no voltage sag. And this goes with your two-way radios too, as well as your cell phones. So when you get down to, you know, 5% on your battery, you're not running into the fact where, oh, I can't call mom now, I can only text message. You know, that's not happening on your phone. But when you call, you're using up more power than you are when you send a text. So there is different power usage, but you're still able to do it all the way down to 0%, which with the lead batteries, that's not the case. So, like the slide says, only 40% on extreme loads. So that's all you're getting out of your battery. All right. So that's what I was talking about with lithium at 0%. The voltage can nosedive and render the battery useless. So monitor the battery with voltage equipment. And I talk about that right here with this software. So if anybody is really looking into getting into, you know, if you have a very high demand use and you are looking to kind of do a little bit of research into the lithium technology and maybe get a lithium setup, because it can save you some money if you're going through a lot of batteries. I didn't know if anybody had a heavy need on batteries, so I wanted to just kind of go over everything that you would need for this type of lithium battery. And like I said, I don't sell these batteries, and you can only find them online. And through my research, the average cost of a 100 amp hour battery is around $1,000. The average cost of a 300 amp hour battery is $3,800. You can see it's a huge investment, but the investment, if done properly, can actually pay off. And that's where this slide comes into play. So it's not something that is definitely not going to hit the market. It's going to hit the market. It's just a matter of when and what type of safety concerns are still out there, because it's still in its early stages. There's still a lot of tests. If you figure this is a new battery and they're saying, oh, it's going to have 5,000 cycles, how do they know that? I think they only know that based off of some of the tests that they've done. They've never really fully cycled a battery to maybe 5,000 cycles, because that's a long time. Question? Yeah, a lot of it is based off of testing and, you know, testing voltages and using knowledge off of other applications. In a hybrid car, they were putting nickel metal hydride cells in it, in battery banks. I don't know what they currently put in the new hybrid cars, especially like the Chevy Volts, the ones that run just off battery power, not even off. I think that's what the Volt does, or is that the Leaf?
Those battery costs like $3,000 to replace the whole bank of them.
They do, yes, and we can't replace them. Only authorized dealers for hybrid cars that have a trained technician on hand can actually deal with those batteries. They're very regulated, because obviously they don't want the wrong person messing with them, and then a fire, or in the event of you getting in a car accident, they want to make sure all the safety precautions are in place so it just doesn't catch on fire all of a sudden. But you can see with anything, it's really about how much you're spending on your batteries, because if you do your application right and you hit that 5,000 charge cycles, your cost, then you're saving about $2,400. So I didn't want to just say how expensive these batteries were, because if I only told you how expensive they were, that would just immediately turn off the door for everybody. I mean, that would just, it would be done. Why would you spend $1,000 on a battery? But if you do it right, you have that monitoring system. There's a lot of people using these batteries. Not as much as lead, because lead has dominated the market for 150 years, but there's people starting to use this technology. More so in solar power banks, banks where they're being charged all the time with the solar system, and you're running all your power through those batteries. Their home systems. All right, so lithium problems and other applications. Samsung had a briefing where they basically explained why there were two battery issues with their phones when they had their battery problems last year. First one was a flaw in the design of the battery. So what they did is the battery consists of basically a thin layer that separates two parts of the battery that if it were to touch, they would short out and likely create a fire. Well, what they did is they designed the battery poorly in one area of the battery that allowed it in certain circumstances to touch and to short and to just catch on fire. And that could either be because the battery swelled a little bit from charging, whatever it was, any little bit of the movement, they claimed the failure was right in that. So what they did is they scrambled to get the situation underhand, because they started finding out that things were catching on fire. So they hired a different battery manufacturer to make batch number two on the recalls, and that manufacturer didn't use the highest grade materials and rushed it, because Samsung was like, we need a million batteries. We need to get these batteries out of the phones and in. And so they just were like, boom. So they just made a bunch of them. And so then they realized, all right, we cannot do that anymore. And so then they had this press conference where they went over those two problems. And now they know the problems that they made, so that they can basically tell their shareholders, we figured out what was wrong. Everything's okay going forward, because we now know what not to do. So this goes over that a little bit more in depth. basically telling you that the battery is layered in three layers, a positive electrode, a negative one, and a third physical layer, which acts as a separator between the first two. So basically what I just mentioned previously, so that's pretty much what caused that issue. And I know it's a concern for a lot of people. And what ends up happening is with your, like, your hoverboard applications, you know, where you're talking about hoverboards catching on fire, they don't want you taking them on planes. It's mostly because of the way that the batteries are regulated. A lot of these batteries are regulated with circuitry, which is part of that. When we were talking about the big batteries, that BMS, the battery management system, if you don't have a good management system monitoring your charge going into your battery and the current being drawn from your battery, it can create issues with lithium. And it can be pretty volatile. It can all of a sudden catch on fire, and it's a hot fire, and it's quick. That's the biggest problem with the hoverboard applications, is that they're left charging somewhere in a house. They overcharge, there's thermal runaway, and it just gets really hot and flames are almost like a flamethrower coming right out, and it catches the house on fire instantly. I mean, it's a really hot fire, and there's no way to extinguish it with normal water, because if you extinguish it with water, it creates a chemical reaction that can actually kill you. So, not really, you know, they really want to make sure that this technology is safe. And for years, we were all under the impression that the cell phone batteries were safe. I mean, there wasn't those fires. So I'm hoping that, you know, Samsung kind of learned their lesson that, in my take, they're trying to make the phones a little too thin, and they're trying to also make sure that their battery life doesn't result because they're removing space for the battery. So I think that issue is isolated to certain applications, like hoverboards is one of them. Another one is the e-cigarettes, although, I've now a year without smoking cigarettes. I've used an e-cigarette device. I haven't had any problems with it. But I can tell you, we sell those batteries. There's certain kinds that are regulated that won't work in the e-cigarettes because they regulate how much current can be drawn from them. They'll only work in certain devices. And that's the only battery that we sell in that actual size, because we don't want to sell a battery that's going to catch on fire. So it's got to have that safety circuitry in it. So there are safe ways to use lithium, and there's unsafe ways to use lithium. The unsafe way would be to just trust that you're buying a regulated lithium battery pack from some place in China. Probably not. You want to buy well-named brands when it comes to lithium products that take lithium batteries, because they ultimately don't want to have what happened to Samsung happen to them, especially now. Because if Samsung didn't have the amount of market share that they have in cell phone industries, that probably would have buried them. They probably would have never recovered from that. Because there's a lot of people in this room who probably have Samsung phones that don't really want to go out and get a new one. We talked about that briefly. So, all right. So it's safety concerns. One of the things is that lithium is actually a little bit harder to ignite in the event of mishandling. So with lead acid, one of the biggest concerns is you have your positive and negative right there. And if you touch metal over the top of it and you have a large bank, I mean, right there, you're melting. Your tool might melt instantly. All your wiring is going to melt almost instantly. So with lithium, it's just harder for that to happen. I guess a good example is another thing is you drove a nail through a lithium battery and it didn't necessarily create a explosion or a fire or anything of that nature. It didn't even cause the batteries to swell up. It could be a result of the safety circuitry that's built into it. Could also just be a good design in the battery separating those plates. Nothing short-circuited is basically what happened, because you check the voltage afterwards and it still had good voltage. So that's just good design in the battery. Well, it had voltage. Had something. If it was shorted, it would have probably been really hot and wouldn't have been able to detect any voltage. So, and one of the things I was mentioning is the early lithium chemistry, lithium cobalt oxide, was extremely hazardous, and a lot of what lithium in the past got really bad reputation for not being allowed on planes. That was mostly what it came from, but recently they're now saying no lithium on planes, so it's just something that's industry. So just a summary, lead acid's the current market leader. Lithium, it's still arriving to the market because lead acid's been dominating the market for 150 years, and safety concerns have slowed the arrival of lithium to most markets. So, we have any questions?
I ordered a drone.
Yes.
And I charge the batteries by putting them in a metal trash can because they get really hot.
Yeah. And that's probably a safe bet because it might be a lithium polymer battery. Is it like
China?
Yeah, okay. And that's another reason why you want to be safe when you charge the batteries, because that's when these fires occur, it's when the batteries are being charged. It's not really in operation. So it's, you know, you really want to, when you charge them, you really want to put them in a safe place.
Struggling with these various chemistries.
Sure.
So I also have an RC battery that's lithium, it's labeled as lithium polymer.
Okay.
Is that different from the lithium iron phosphate?
It is. It's technically it's a different design of the lithium, and it can react a little bit differently than lithium ion. Lithium polymers is there. That would be a good follow-up question. So if you wanted to know the difference between lithium ion and lithium polymer, it's a little bit more on the technical side more than I memorized for today. But I do have that information available. So I have my card up here. Just shoot me an email, and I'll definitely get back to you on that one.
The lithium iron phosphate you're talking about is something new and different.
Lithium iron phosphate is what you'll find in those applications. I was the application for any type of runtime batteries, like in the big banks, and then for your e-cigarettes, the hoverboard type stuff. Those are all taking that type of technology, which is the cylindrical technology. It's more of like a battery cell in most cases. That's what if you opened up a laptop battery, you'd find that it has what looks like a oversized AA and a bunch of them tabbed together to a circuit board. That is, you know, essentially lithium ion, which is lithium iron phosphate.
But for our cell phones, isn't it a good rule of thumb to maybe recharge them when they're down to 50-60%?
You don't have to, but if you always are recharging it, you do run the risk of potentially overcharging a battery. See,
isn't there smarts in the battery to shut off?
Yes.
The charger?
So it's was really a big issue with some of the earlier model phones. A lot of your Motorola's, they didn't like to be overcharged, so they recommended to fully discharge them more frequently. But now they're kind of incorporating that technology into the phone charging system. So when you get to 100%, it's not going to really damage the battery life.
The
it's just going to cut off.
Built into the battery? Or
built into the phone. Into the phone, not into the battery. So basically, it was a big deal. Now it's not so much a big deal. So, yeah. So, I mean, what I recommend to people is never let it get down to zero and stay dead. Because what I've noticed is that's what kills people's batteries.
What can you tell us about laptop batteries?
About laptop batteries? Well, what I can say about laptop batteries is basically most of them are only taking lithium ion, not the lithium polymer. And really, there's no risk on a lithium battery being a problem in a laptop unless it's swollen. And in that case, you're replacing it anyways. So once it swells, then you definitely want to take precautions, and that's not a battery you really want to use and have in your house.
That's what happened on this. There were three packs of these. One of them swelled up about twice this size, and I found it and replaced it. Kept the two that hadn't swelled up. I threw the other in the trash can. All right.
Okay. Yeah. Well, it's too late now, but. If that happens, you can bring it to Batteries Plus, and we will dispose of it. We currently received a huge batch of lithium batteries that were very swollen, and we found that we never really received batteries that were that bad. They were dropped off by a commercial customer that dealt with a lot of those batteries, and I'm not sure how they got that many bad batteries, but they were almost like a circle when they were flat. So when something like that comes into the store, we do have to dispose of it differently than other stuff. We almost have to put like a vermiculite in, we have to put it in a plastic bag, then we have to put it in a special container, and then surround it with vermiculite, and ship off one battery alone by itself. So it is a safety concern. They're actually taking it more serious now than they did in prior years. You're going to find out that it's going to be hard to order online and get things quick in lithium technology because UPS and FedEx has said, we don't really want to ship this overnight and we're not putting them on planes anymore. So everything's going UPS ground and it's going to take a while. So that's a recent change that you're going to see happen pretty frequently.
In airports, when the TSA says, do you have any lithium ion batteries? And I'm standing there with a laptop, a tablet, an HT, a cell phone, and a smartwatch.
You're taking the train.
So you're fine as long as they're in your device. So as long as they're in your... Now, I say that, but recent changes, if you're traveling from certain countries, you cannot bring those, only your cell phone. But if you're leaving from the United States, that was something I actually did research on about a year ago when I wanted to bring my my e-cigarette with me on the plane. I found out that I could bring it as long as it was inside my device. If it was outside of my device, it had to be in the original packaging. And I think even that, they could take it out of my suitcase.
You don't carry a spare battery.
Yeah, you don't want to carry a spare battery, you know, unless you have another device you can put it into. So, yep.
Can you address these small car charger batteries that are lithium? You know, they draw 100 amps, but of course you can't use it for like 10 seconds.
Talking about like the boosters?
On the market the last couple of years.
Yeah, like they're like booster packs. Like if your car battery's not starting, you can.
So how do you get 100 amps out of a small?
Well,
one time.
That's part of one of the benefits of this technology is the fact that you can get a large amount of current drawn from the battery without sacrificing that that voltage sag. So what they're allowed to do is they're allowed to use a smaller battery option to get as much power as they did with the larger lead acid battery because they had to compensate for that only using 40% of the battery's total cranking power because they're trying to get, you know, so essentially in lead applications, they end up using more battery than is really necessary because of the downside. So you end up having a heavier system, you know, you have more space being occupied by the battery, so that changes the design of the whole system, and it's heavier. So that's why lead stuff is bigger and weighs more, and the lithium stuff is now coming out as really tiny and very lightweight, because lithium is about half the weight of lead in the big technology, but obviously in the smaller stuff, it's a fraction of the weight. So,
kind of out of time.
Right, yeah, okay.
But you wanted to encourage our members to visit your
store. Yes. Essentially, what I wanted to do was basically go over some of the battery technologies that are used in the bigger ham radios. And if people had questions about the smaller radios, just to come in and just ask us questions about it. Because that's essentially what makes us different than other stores is that we encourage people to come in and ask us questions. We want to make sure that you're leaving with what you want and what actually is good for your application. So... I actually brought something that if it wasn't 25 pages, I would have printed out and given everybody, and it would have answered just about every single question that you could have on this technology. So, I mean, it's a pretty much an extensive guidebook. If anybody comes and visits me at the store and would like a copy of this, it's a Bible of pretty much sealed lead acid batteries. It has everything you need to know about it. If you want to calculate how much runtime you're going to get out of your battery system, and you want to know how to do that, this is what you need.
Is there a PDF somewhere available?
I don't. I might actually be able, if I can access it that way, we have a specialized site that will allow me to print this off, and it doesn't allow me to download it. I can see if I can get a PDF file of it.
But do you have a jail if we possess it?
No. This one, see this, if you were to openly distribute this, potentially you could run a risk, because it does say on the bottom, you know, confidential proprietary information. So, but this doesn't say that. So that's why I'm definitely happy to, you know, hand this out in mass quantities to anybody. So I'm pretty sure this is information that Batteries Plus has gathered from a bunch of different sources, so that I have a Bible to go to. So, and I'm happy to also go over nickel metal and NICAD too. So if anybody needs fact sheets on that, come by the store, I'll print them off. Because I could go over that technology, all the specifics, all day long, but there's always going to be some stuff that pops up, a different application, a different question. So just feel free to give me a call and ask me.
Also, you're going to talk about your discount program.
Yes.
That you're going to make available to club members.
Yes, yes. I want to mention that. But I think we had one more question. Do you have?
What hours are you in the store?
Oh, okay. So the only day of the week that really I'm not at the store is on a Wednesday. Other than that, you can pretty much find me. And if you can't find me, I'm always available. You can call the store, press 3, that'll ring my cell phone. And if I don't answer, leave me a message, and I'll get right back to you. So you can always find me. But talking about the discount program, what I'm going to do is I am going to set up Albemarle Amateur Radio Club as AARC in our system. And when you come in to buy batteries for your radios, you just say, I'm with the Albemarle Amateur Radio Club, and we'll pull up that account and sell you your batteries under that account. Now, the difference between that and purchasing it under your own account is the fact that you're going to be sharing account information with all the other members of the radio club. So if you have a warranty issue or anything like that, we're going to have to search through all of those purchases to find your purchase. Whereas if you bought it on your account, we would be able to find it there. Maybe it might be the only purchase you had. So that's the only downside to doing that. Everything else is an upside. You get a big discount, and it saves you money on your radio application, which could be beneficial, you know, as something that I wanted to offer to you guys. And one battery sale right there could take care of a lot of other expenses. So an example I threw is, you know, one of the general purpose batteries we sell, that's an 8-amp-hour battery, it retails for $39.99 with the radio club's discount. You'd be looking at, I want to say it's
$18.95. That's
a small UPC. Yeah, yeah, battery backup system. That's where you commonly see that particular battery. Or in your fire alarm panel for your security system.
$50.
Yeah. Yeah, and if you get the security guy to come out to do it, yeah, you're spending a large amount of money when you could just be spending $15, $16. So that's something I wanted to extend to you guys as a thank you for letting me come out here and talk to you about batteries.
Do you want a battery pack?
Yeah, we do. That's actually one of the main things that separates us from a lot of our local competition is we rebuild NICAD and nickel metal high drive battery packs. We don't do lithium, though. Yeah, we do not do lithium, because lithium does require regulated, static-free environment, and not something that we feel comfortable spot welding onto. So.
Thank you.